Well, hello everybody and welcome to Calgary. I was in Ontario over the weekend and I can't tell you if I like the weather better there or here. It was nice to get back into some cool weather, so it was quite a bit different. I've got a few opening remarks I wanted to make, and besides welcome you and the 220 of us that are in the room today, so it's a great turnout. I also wanted to thank our organizing committee because they've done a terrific job in getting things in place for you, and I hope you have a wonderful few days here in Calgary. Spend a bit of money. We need your money. I'm going to take you through this. This is us. We're about 1.2, 1.3 million people in size. The average age of Calgary is 37. We're ethnically diverse. We were once known as the cowboy redneck city in Western Canada. I think we no longer have that tag. People come from all over the world to make Calgary home, so we're very fortunate. I'm proud of the fact that our employees believe that this is a good place for us to work, and they're proud of the work that they do on behalf of the citizens of Calgary. So it's a great place to live, and we've got a number of recognitions around that. Just for those of you in the audience that do this type of work, we keep a scorecard, and this is all we report back to council on, basically telling council these are the things that are important to our organization. So when we're looking at our satisfaction from our employees and our reputation, the pride that we have in the work that we do, the scores that we get from our citizens in terms of the services that we deliver and the quality of life they have in Calgary, and also our financial position. That's something that we make sure that we're always telling council that, you know, we're making progress on the scorecard that we have in front of them. It's been an interesting journey over the last little bit, especially since the middle of 2015. We've been in an economic downturn, the likes of which we haven't seen for over 30 years in Calgary. And so we've been responding to economic circumstances that's new to many people that work for the city. I'm going to talk a little bit about innovation. And you're going to hear some quotes from Yogi Berra, who's my favorite philosopher. So, you know, it's funny. I don't know if everybody knows who Yogi Berra is, but he's a famous baseball player, played for the Yankees in the 50s and 60s. And I was delivering a speech on innovation to a younger crowd. This goes back a year or so ago. And I mentioned Richard Nixon, and everybody's face went blank. So I thought I'd better tell you that who Yogi Berra is. They didn't know who Richard Nixon was. This is Calgary in the last, since 2010. We went through a worldwide recession. We had a rapid recovery in 2011, 2012. We had a major flood with 100,000 people displaced in 2013. In 2014, we were the fastest growing city in North America. In 2015, we in a bust. In 2017, we started to see a tepid recovery. That's an eight-year period of time. So for those of us in terms of dealing with change within local government, it was a significant change going to try to accommodate 50,000 people that were coming to our city in 2014, and in 2015, losing 10,000 people. So you can recognize that over that period of time, the bottom line of the organization was significantly impacted. And I'm proud to say that we took $500 million out of our bottom line, and we lost very few jobs. So we were able to continue to provide services and keep our employees working within the city of Calgary. But it's certainly different than what it's been before, and I'd say that it's certainly different for all of us that are in government. When you take a look at the things that are driving change and innovation in the world today, whether it's artificial intelligence, 3D printing, quantum mechanics, blockchain, neurotechnologies, the Internet of Things, any of those types of things that are driving the change that are happening in the economies, in the cities that we support, in the communities that we're trying to enable. I was saying last night that when I came into municipal government, I was dealing with punch cards. Does anybody know what punch cards are? There's a few of us around the room, right? We're dealing with mainframes, floppy disks, and my first desktop computer was a Radio Shack TRS-80. So when you think about where we've been in the last 20 or 30 years or longer, I hate to say how long I've been working in municipal government, but ultimately things are completely different than what we're dealing with 30 years ago. And many of us are still in charge today. So the obligation that we have to our organization is that we need to be able to enable those people in our organization that have different thinking, that see the world differently, that want to create, that want to innovate, that want to establish something different in municipal government, and allow those people the opportunity to come forward. You know, and that leads to this point here, is that innovation is really about making mistakes. And Yogi said it really too well. He said, we make too many wrong mistakes. And the fact is, there are right mistakes to make. If you're not making mistakes, if you're not challenging one another, if you're not experimenting, if you're not taking some risks, you're not going to be able to change the way in which we deliver services. And so the obligation that we have in this room and the reason why we all get together is to talk about how we can deliver service and make life better for people. And that's really the thing that I hope you take away from this conference. At least take something that you learned here and try to do it within your municipality or within whatever organization you're working in, because it's critical to the future that we start embracing things that are going on around us. Forbes magazine's quote is, good employees make mistakes. And I think most of you are in a leadership position within this room today. Great leaders allow them to do so. This is something that's important to me, and I hope it's something that you can appreciate, that if we're gonna create risk within an organization, you also need to create psychological safety. And what psychological safety is about, talks about me as a leader, talks about me as an employee, that I feel safe in making some of the judgments that need to be made. I feel safe in terms of experimenting. I feel safe that if mistakes come forward, that I'm going to be supported and my back is covered, and that I'm not going to be on the front pages of the newspaper defending myself, that something went wrong under my watch and I'm responsible for it, and now I've been held accountable for a mistake that ultimately we're trying to push for innovation and change and creativity within an organization. And you can see the difference of in levels from low on the one side of the chart to high. You know, you can see where that continuum really is. And so where do you place yourself as a leader, and where do you place yourself as an organization within that continuum? And what are you doing within your organization to ensure people feel safe in following your lead and taking those chances and experimenting within your organization? Because if you don't have a strategy around that and you're not dealing with that situation, you're never going to get people that are prepared to put their head above the top of the fence. It's absolutely critical from that perspective. And it's important that you understand and communicate to your employees what risk is all about, what the appetite within the organization is, and what the tolerance within the organization is to risk. Because if you don't have that conversation, if you don't talk about risk, you're never going to get to a point where you can actually innovate. So it's an important conversation that you need to lead within your organizations. And this is really the reason why. Because at the end of the day, you don't want to lead an organization that's apathetic. And if you're stuck with low psychological safety and low demanding goals, you get nowhere. But if you increase the psychological safety, but if you don't increase the demanding goals at the same time, all you do is creating a level of comfort within the organization everybody is accustomed to. There's no challenge. There's no impetus. There's nothing that's going to cause the organization to move forward. There's nothing there that's going to cause individuals to say, you know what, I'd like to take on something different. You know, and when you consider that it's not in my job description, is something that we all have to battle through, and to allow people to work with outside the boundaries of those job descriptions. It's this chart that I hope that you'll take back to your organizations and take a look at and say, where are we on this chart? And how are we going to create a learning organization where we're challenging folks with demanding goals, but at the same time creating a high level of social psychological safety so they're not in an anxiety situation? You know, right now we're dealing with the Olympics. It's been a tough project. Split in terms of the support and the people that have been working on that project. It hasn't been exactly one of the things that I would say that has been an easy project to actually be involved in. We've gone through quite a bit of people, quite a few staff that have been involved in that project because it burns them out. And so from the perspective of saying, how do you get that situation where they're not feeling anxious about the work that they're doing, but they're actually learning and we're moving forward, it's been an interesting journey, I can tell you, something I certainly haven't experienced before. The other part is that all of you have an obligation within this room to think. And Yogi says, I think that you can't think and hit at the same time. And that's the same that holds true for all of you. If you're working every day and you're focused on operations and you're involved in projects and initiatives, and that's where your time is consumed, and there's no time in your day to actually step back, think about what you're doing, set some different targets, talk about where you want to go in the future, what you need to do differently. If you're not creating that time, then you're leaving the organization short of your leadership responsibilities. I don't care how you go about doing that. And whether that's getting out in the morning and having a walk or going on a bike ride or, you know, sitting around with some colleagues over coffee, it's absolutely critical you you carve out time in your schedule to sit and think about what's going on, because you're not going to be able to hit and think at exactly the same time. Now, I've got a bone to pick about best practices, and it's probably something that my guys have heard me say all the time. I hate the internet from the perspective of saying that you can go on the internet and you can Google something, and now you all of a sudden you've researched what goes on every other place in the universe, and you come back and you say these are the best practices, and you've learned absolutely nothing. All you're now doing is duplicating the same things that other people are doing, and you're calling that best practices. You know, all across the country, we're kind of like sheep. We jump on the same bandwagon all at the same time. You know, we all wanted to have cycle tracks. I'm not saying they're a bad thing. I'm just telling you we did it all at the same time. Okay? You take a look at what we do as a profession. And every time we see something happening and pop up in another area, we jump on that bandwagon, and then we go to our councils with some new ideas in a report that we want them to approve that are going to set some regulations and bylaws to establish these best practices within our organization. And so Yogi says, when you come to a fork in the road, take it. That's how I feel about how we run government through the internet and Google searches. But I think the more important one is the one from Carl Sandburg. It says, two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled, and that has made all the difference. And I believe in that. We're there to make a difference. It's important that what you take out of this today is at least take something home that says, I'm going to do something different when I get there, because this was the road that was less traveled. There's 220 of you in this room today that can actually make a difference in the places that you work. So I wanted to thank you for that opportunity. I want to thank you for all coming here today. I'm so grateful that you made your journey to Calgary. I'm proud of the city that I live in. I hope you enjoy your visit here and have a wonderful conference. Thanks, everyone.